It's been a really fun 2 days so far. My name is CJ. I'm joined on the couch by Chalky and Firebat. Firebat, you got eliminated yesterday, but other than that, how have you been enjoying the event so far, man?
Yeah, it's been really fun. These events are always like a vacation, right? You just like hang out with friends. You get drunk a lot. It's like a big party, and especially when you lose, because then you have a lot less that you need to focus on.
Pressure, a lot less pressure.
Yeah, there's pretty much no more pressure at all once you've lost. You're pretty much done at that point.
Yeah.
And then you just hang out and have a good time. So there's some upside to, you know, losing, but it generally feels pretty bad.
Chalky, do you share the same sentiments as a fellow player who lost yesterday?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't realize the start of the cast was going to be just TJ telling me how bad I was.
I
was really hoping to have like a good fun cast.
You know,
it's
going to
be great, guys.
And TJ's just like, Fireman, how does it feel to suck?
Combined on this desk, we have 0 wins.
Wow.
Yeah, I did get, I got 0-2'd as well.
Yeah.
I went 0-0.
I could have won my first game. I feel like I made one misplay, and I feel like that costed me the series against Zixo because he also made a misplay that costed him a game. And then that gave me like a huge leg up, and as long as I didn't make any mistakes, I would have won. But I made that one mistake, and that cost me. And then against Forsen, I feel like I made no mistakes except maybe very small minor things that maybe would have cost like 1% edge on either side. And just Yogg. It's a good card.
Yeah, it is a good card.
Yeah.
And first matchup of the day is going to be Orange versus Life Coach. And both these guys are in their new groups. I think that matches.
Yeah, this is just the...
Okay. Well, first of all, let's take a look at the groups that we're going to see today. Of course, we narrowed it down to the top 16. We had 8 groups to start. The top 2 of each of those groups were reseeded into these groups.
Yep.
And so those are the 16 players that remain. I guess all 32 players were strong coming in.
For sure.
Group B, though, that's a group of death right there.
I mean, any group with Frodan.
Frodan's been beasting it, dude.
Yeah.
I think Frodan maybe played a little bit sloppier than a lot of the other players, but I think he's got one of the better lineups out of all the players here.
Yeah.
And like, by lineup, you mean the one deck he played
the bog
6 times consecutively.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I know all of his decks because I helped prepare with Frodan. Yeah.
It's just kind of hard to call his lineup great until we really see it come into action.
I know all of the cards in all of his decks.
Huh.
Wow. So cool.
And I like his lineup a lot. I think Frodan practiced really hard for this tournament, and I hope he does well. He's brought like a really interesting lineup. He didn't do the same thing as everybody else, and I respect that a lot.
Frodan is like more competitive than almost all of the players here. It feels like.
Well,
he's got like a thirst for competition that cannot be sated.
Yeah, it gets sated after a couple years, but.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's different when it's new. Like, it's a new feeling. Like, as a caster, you sit there and you watch people. There's no glory in casting.
You just get pumped up. Every time I cast, I feel like the first thing I want to do after I'm done casting is grind out some Hearthstone.
It just
motivates you so much. You see all the plays and you're like, yeah, I can do this. I want to play. And then you play one game and you're like, all right, it's time for bed. This is awful.
Yeah.
Why am I putting myself through this torture?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Feels bad, man. But Group A is actually probably the, on a more serious note, is the group that probably has the strongest line of players. Orange and Life Coach is our first matchup. Zixo as well is in that first group.
Yeah, I would agree that those are some scary players. And Zalay as well, like... Zalay's been like one of the best North American players, I'd say, for like a while. He just hasn't had that big tournament breakout point yet. But like every time you play with Zalay or you watch Zalay's stream, for example, he's always got like a lot of good analysis and generally speaking makes the better plays. Lately, he's been kind of deviating from that and being more of just like a troll streamer for the viewers because he's like getting sad with competition because he's been trying so hard, right?
Yeah.
For so long, and he just hasn't broken out yet, and that's demoralizing at some point. But I would really like to see him have a good showing in this group, so you know maybe he's gets more motivated to stay on the competitive instead of getting more sad with how things have been going for him lately.
Chalky was at a point like that once.
It happened.
Was
sad about competing,
and then I won
the win.
And now
I lost a couple times. And now we're back to square one.
Is the sadness back?
You know, it kind of is, but...
gotta wait
after just one tournament, the sadness
Like prelims too. I mean, I don't know. I've got a lot of competition coming up in August. Like, realistically, I'm doing really well. I'm like first seed in summer standings. I'm first seed in the ONOG standings. Seventh in last call standings. So I don't know. Things are going well. I just O2'd two tournaments in a row. Sucks.
Does suck for sure. Did you rewatch the games and learn things?
No, I don't care. I don't know. Compared to like everyone down in the basement where everyone like comes down after their games and they like talk up a storm like for 2 hours about one play. Like I come down and everybody's telling me stuff. And I'm like, don't care.
Chucky comes down after getting O2 and he says, hey, you guys want to go get ice cream?
We need to get that ice cream and it's happening after this match. We finally got the Euros to do it. No one in this city takes credit card. It is bad.
Well, yeah, doesn't Germany, they mainly have like a debit system, right? Not very much credit system.
I don't know. I don't care. It's kind of like the plays. I just want my ice cream.
Oh, man. But
it's all it takes.
You have to be analytical, though, and go back to find success.
Nah.
Really?
Yeah.
You just kind of just YOLO it out there every time? And
I mean, I learn, but I don't need like, you know, armchair analysts. Like, but I don't worry about what the casters say or what other people say, really. I can learn from my own mistakes.
So you don't think it's very beneficial to factor in others' opinions as well and just build off of every possible resource?
Nah. He factors my
opinion.
I think people focus way too much on like the way you lost that one game, and it's important to kind of look at, you know, were you happy with your lineup? Did you make mistakes? Sure. How do you fix those mistakes? For me, it's probably just practicing my decks more, like personally. Like, I didn't play enough Freeze Mage for the event. That was kind of like my fourth most practiced deck. So, like, the other three decks I felt really comfortable with. Freeze, I didn't. And then my fifth deck was Druid, and I don't feel comfortable with that still, but I never had to play that. So, I'm just going to go play more Hearthstone.
If you could have made a change... Like if someone said, here, Chucky, you have a time machine. You can make one change before coming to Steel Story Cup.
I don't know. I guess just learn about coming to Steel Story Cup more weeks in advance so I can play more. I didn't have much time to prepare, especially for LHS. Like, LHS is so much different than Conquest. And we just couldn't find a lineup we liked, being me and Nossum. So we just went with kind of a standard lineup, and honestly I'm pretty happy to see people with like weird lineups doing really well. Like the whole Bog Creeper thing honestly kind of makes me like happy to see, like, even though a lot of people are just calling it bad, it does really well against some of the more standard decks, and that's kind of nice to see considering from practice a lot of players are sad. They're just like, the four best decks are just the four best decks, and everybody's going to bring them, and we're all going to lose.
Yeah, that's how my practice experience went as well. Like, I was trying to play things that beat the four best decks over and over and over again, and I kept losing to the four best decks.
You just lose to them, yeah.
And then I started just playing the four best decks, and I was able to beat some of the players that were bringing these wacky things.
Yeah.
Like, for example, I practiced with Froden, right? And I 4-0'd him a few, or 3-0'd him a few times before the event, and I was like, yeah, my lineup seems pretty solid. And then...
If your group is Froden.
I guess. Yeah, so, I don't know. And then you just lose the coin flip against the standard decks, and it hurts the soul.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. It's tough to tell what's unlucky and what's, you know, mistakes in preparation.
On the bright side, sometimes Yogg is fun to watch, so we got that going for us. But
this isn't a Yogg, though. This is a C'Thun druid.
I think it has Yogg in it.
The Yogg C'Thun druid.
He's double god, according to his Twitter.
Yeah.
I can only assume the other god is...
Gods on gods.
Yeah.
It's going to be Yashiraj.
There's no way it's triple god. That's just too many gods, right?
Yeah.
At that point, your gods fight with each other.
I forgot
more
even
than
what
they
the fourth
you.
God is.
N'Zoth?
Oh, N'Zoth. Oh, my goodness.
That's a good god.
That is probably one
of the best cards in the set.
Yeah. All right, well, first game between Orange and Life Coach. This is the first game of Group A as well. Life Coach with mid-range Shaman and Orange with the double god Druid.
Yeah, I haven't seen too much of the double god druid. It's not really a deck you'd see too often on ladder. Usually it's like one of the other gods. Mm-hmm. And when it's only, you know, just the C'Thun, I'd have to give a slight edge to the mid-range shaman in my experience. But maybe double god helps a little bit in this matchup. I could see definitely Yogg helping in a lot of matchups, especially board-centric matchups, right? Because Yogg has such a great ability to clean up like a mid-range shaman's late-game board.
I don't know. I really like... C'Thun Druid versus Mid Shaman.
Oh, yeah?
I've had good success in that matchup.
Oh, why do you think that is?
I don't know.
This analyst is just like,
you're just
killing it.
You literally, you just like, C'Thun Druid's so fun, you just play dumb stuff on curve and You draw your... I don't know. One thing I was talking to players about was the fact that I keep Twin Emperor every time,
okay.
No matter what.
It does have a pretty high chance of being active.
That card is bonkers, and if you're not keeping it, you're doing it wrong.
Okay.
And that's... a lot of people disagreed with that.
I have never heard of that until you said it yesterday, but yeah, it's very interesting. I don't think anyone else keeps it. I think that's the Chalky special.
Well, like, I feel like people would keep it if they have, like...
The cards
other cards
yeah,
that
sure.
support it, where, like, they have an activator and a wild growth, and they're like, okay.
Yeah, then
but, like, I keep it no matter what.
And it works out for you.
I had pretty good success with Cthundruid in the past.
So that's a tip for all you ladder players out there. If you're grinding some Cthundruid, Dr.
Yeah.
Chalky
it's just
says,
fun to play.
You know what you should do if you're playing against me? You should keep Cthune also.
I've the kept Cthune before.
The deck's built around it. Why not?
With nothing
you guys
else.
Are getting kind of out of control. There's no way you keep...
I did it against Control Warrior. It's the only way you lose is if you don't draw Cthune.
Or you just don't have a curve at all.
No, you still win then.
Yeah, when I play
Cthune's
Tempo Mage...
really good.
When I play Tempo Mage, I just keep Yoxeron.
Guys, these cards cost 10.
I just keep Nuzoth and my Paladin.
Farfetch's like, I have no idea what's real anymore. Well,
real competitive game.
That entire banter took up one life coach turn.
Yeah.
We're going to run out of material. I'll tell you that much right now.
If this goes to game five, whew.
I do like the coin ferals. We get a huge buff on this tunnel trog, and we have another tunnel trog to follow up using the free mana there. We get the overload out of the way so we can ensure the ability to get this fire elemental down and hex going into like the later turns of orange when he's going to be most likely to be playing minions you want to hex.
Yeah.
So, seems good, man.
Yeah. Orange, it's either Double Wrath or Cthune's Chosen here. So, Cthune's Chosen, you got to think, there's only one mana left for Life Coach. So,
yep.
Does Cthune's Chosen get punished by anything?
You got to be afraid of, I guess, like, you think about, like, Rock Butter and Lightning Bolt, right? Those are the one yep. mana removals. None of those really punish you that bad, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, not too bad. I mean... You do kind of give him a target for them, but he has to trade in a Spirit Wolf.
Yeah.
The problem here is, like, now Life Coach probably takes these value trades on your 1-1s, and now you're running your 4-2 Divine Shield into a 2-2, which isn't that insane. But Double Wrath as an alternative didn't look much better, so... Yeah, no.
You want to be wrathing, like, when you're ahead, or even with this hand potentially for draw, right? Like, if Orange top decks something kind of high mana cost, he may be forced to just try and find plays because... His hand right now is looking pretty dismal. Getting a little bit punished maybe for running two gods in his druid.
Yeah.
Like, it's great when it works out on curve, right? But then it can also give you the potential for awkward draws like this, which may be one of the incentives for it in last year's standing, right? It gives you more potential to just get these nutty draws where you can win bad matchups, but yeah. lower the consistency of the deck.
Yeah. I would always say, like, Yoxeron only takes up one slot in the deck, but when that one slot in the deck is what you draw on turn five...
Yeah, it's bad. But when it's bad. When you draw it on turn 10 and you're in an unfavorable matchup and you just win,
yep,
it's pretty good.
Yeah.
And you're guaranteed, if you win a game, to get an unfavorable matchup, right?
Yep.
So because of the way that the format works out. So the text choice seems pretty good.
Yeah.
I don't like it.
Oh, why not?
I don't know.
I mean, it's just like, I've played a lot of Cthune Druid. And I feel like you really just want to focus on that Cthune strategy. Like, I don't even know how he found the room for that, because Cthune Druid doesn't cast that many spells. Like, I would assume he added Raven Idols. It's like, what are you cutting at that point?
Well, Raven Idols were originally in Cthune Druid back in the early build.
I think everyone kind of, like, got off
well,
of it, though.
I mean, you have Raven Idol, Wild Growth, Innervate, Swipe, Wrath. That's already 10.
Well, we're talking about if there is, like, Raven Idol. Like, because Chucky's saying that all of the latest
I would assume he
kind of
does have it.
Okay.
When you play Yogg, you kind of have to play.
If you have Raven Idol, that counts as like two additional spells.
Yeah.
As well. So you're up to
like
12.
Well, it's
2 for
1, yeah.
Yeah.
The thing is, there's no spells that buff Cthune.
Right. Like, you're deviating from your Cthune strategy so hard that you kind of, you know, miss out.
Ooh.
That's sick.
If I was going to draw a card that turn, that would be the one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Too bad it's...
Right into that ribbit.
Yeah, so but it clears the path for Ancient of War, so...
Sure.
If you were obviously, you'd
Ancient of War
no
gets
hacks.
Traded into with the Fire Elemental and just dies, though, for basically nothing.
Look, I didn't say it's great.
Yeah, Orange is down a slippery slope to nowhere here. Life Coach is just taking his early game board lead and just snowballing it away.
And the Double Gods aren't looking too great this game.
They're very shiny, though.
Yeah. So. If you were going to design a card that was a spell, that was a C'Thun buffing spell, what would it be?
Design a spell that's a C'Thun buffing spell.
3 mana, deal 3 damage to a minion. If your C'Thun has 10 plus 10 attack or more, put Yogg-Saron in your hand.
All right, I got it.
That sounds almost busted.
All right.
Yeah.
Spend all your mana. For each mana spent, give your C'Thun plus 2 plus 2.
Oh, my God.
You know, if you make that plus 1 plus 1, it might actually be balanced.
Just on...
What if there's, like, a 10 mana spell that's just, like, double the attack power of your C'Thun?
10 mana spell.
Whoa.
Summon a C'Thun.
What, like a 6-6?
Well, if you have your C'Thun buffed, it's better.
But it doesn't get the battle cry?
Doesn't get the battle cry. That's balanced.
No, that seems like a bad spell.
It is bad.
That sounds awful.
Hey, man, it's not designed for you guys. It's designed for, you know, the plebs out there.
I'm sure they would enjoy it. Twice the C'Thun.
Good on Chalky for thinking about the plebs. Well, it's got a lot of stuff, a lot of heavy stuff.
Yeah, I like this Thunder Bluff Valiant and then make a Totem play. That seems really good. Your opponent is on 9 mana, so they can't Yogg or C'Thun yet. You get that Thunder Bluff down and start trucking away.
Doomhammer him.
Doomhammer seems
just get him.
It's a lot of damage, so I wouldn't mind it, honestly. I think it's fine as well.
You push 8 this turn.
Push 8.
Yeah. You know your opponent's holding on to 10 drops, or at least one 10 drop, right?
I mean, I really don't dislike the Thunder Bluff because Drew just has no answer to it.
Yeah, it's a 3-6.
It seems like the safer play, but like Life Coach probably knows there's no Harrison.
Okay.
And when you push 8, what really beats you? I don't know. This definitely does open the door if there was a Harrison, though.
Yeah. So Orange needs like an Innervate.
Yeah. Innervate would do it.
Disciple of C'Thun won't.
Rip.
He is dead.
Yep.
Neither of the gods.
Yikes.
Safety.
And all the fears that you guys had earlier on sort of came true there for Orange. Both of those old gods clogging up his hand.
Yeah. So that's one of the downsides to the deck, but it still has the potential upsides. If you do get that win, you have a higher percent chance on your next game to get a win in your bad matchup.
Yeah.
And that may be why we see that deck actually popping up in a lot of players' decks that have made it to the second group stage.
I don't know. I feel like Yogg...
I mean, you can't argue with the results, right? There's other people with that deck.
Is there? Chalky. How many?
Doesn't, like, all of the Temple Storm people have that deck?
I don't know.
I'm pretty sure it's, like...
Well, Gaara has, like,
has a really weird one.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and he lost.
I think,
and he lost, so he got weeded out.
Just Saiyan has the Double God C'Thun. Okay.
Yeah, he played on the B stream at the end of the day yesterday.
Yeah, so.
I just don't like it.
Just
stick to one god, man.
Do you like this zoo variant? No Forbidden Ritual.
Well, considering I didn't bring it, not really. But you know, like you said, these guys are winning. But
I like this variant a lot better.
Zixo's been winning with this variant as well.
Yeah, effectively Zixo's list, but instead of Wrathguard with a Crazed Alk. I like that. Oh, no, this is not that. This is Possessed Villager. Okay.
I do like the Crazed Alk tech in Zoo. Kind of, if you're not going to ban Freeze Mage, it makes sense based on like Firebat's logic he was talking about, where your opponent's always going to counter queue you after you win. So having kind of that hedge against your worst counter does make your win rate quite a bit higher. And it's also good against Shaman. Always kill the totem. Hopefully a Flame Tongue.
That mana tied off Tuskar.
Yeah.
Gotta have an answer.
You can also just make trades better in the other game if you need it.
Yeah. Can just use it on their Trog.
Use it on an Ancient of War.
Yeah. Just uproot it yourself.
Yeah.
Just rip it right out of the earth.
Just do it to it.
Yeah. Oh, this is actually an interesting zoo list because it's not. It's like a hybrid.
Yeah.
It runs Possessed Villager, which means it probably runs PO.
I think this is the number one on Asia's zoo list. I can't remember the guy's name, but he's got the one Lance Carrier in there, and I think he had... there's no Leroy and no Doomguard in that list.
Well,
wasn't there two Lance Carriers?
There's two Lance Carriers.
Because he threw one away and got one back.
Okay, then never mind. It's not that list. But that list also had, like, Bran and Crazed Alk and
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, Zoo's kind of just a deck you can toy with a lot.
Yeah, you can put in whatever you're feeling.
Like, it's a very changeable list.
When you can put in Lance Carrier.
Yeah.
It's a pretty flexible deck.
Yeah. Hey, man, Lance
Carrier is Lance Carrier.
It's another buff card, which is extremely powerful in, you know, these kind of grindy matchups where you need to fight for board, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
It's just not quite enough to get the job done here up against the Totem Golem, but... Yeah, Imp Gang Boss might be able to contest quite nicely. You go Imp Gang Boss and you hope there's no Flame Tongue Totem.
Do you? Or do you hope there's a Flame Tongue Totem? And then Crazed Alchemist it.
Yeah.
Okay. You do get to do that.
The old bait and switch.
There's really no switch involved.
No, there's you're switching the attack and the health.
Oh!
Hey! Whoa!
Oh, man. But you don't get to kill the Totem Golem, which is kind of sad, and...
TJ just gives me the biggest smirk ever.
If the Life Coach is able to pave the way for the Flame Wreath Faceless quite nicely, even against Orange's, like, best punish. Unless Orange, you know, top deck's, like, Abusive Sergeant here. That would be magical.
Yeah.
Wow. That is good.
Oh, yeah?
That is the best card he could have top decked in this situation.
Yeah, he's got the perfect answer.
Steep.
Oh my
it's
god.
It's like Lord of the Rings, right?
You don't remember that scene? Did you ever see
Lord of the Rings?
What? Oh my god.
I'm not a big movie guy.
Get out.
Lord of the Rings are really long movies.
No, Jackie, don't get out. They are really long movies.
Yeah, you have to be really committed to watching it when you start that one. Like, that's not a movie you can just be like a casual, fun movie to watch. You got to be prepared mentally.
It actually, The Two Towers, which is the movie that I'm afraid to, came out a long time ago.
And that was like the worst one, right?
No, the last one was the worst one, I thought.
The third one?
Yeah, the second one just had fights all the way through.
Yeah.
I thought the third one was a lot better than the second one.
Yeah, maybe. The third one had like 45 minutes at the end that was just like useless.
Yeah.
Just Frodan and a... Frodan.
Wait, Frodan was Frodan. In Lord of the Rings?
Yeah, it was just Frodan in a bed.
Really?
That was the last 45 minutes of Lord of the Rings.
Sick. Whoa, he didn't storm. What do you think about this? He's going with the Rockbiter trade instead.
He wants Storm for Forbidden Ritual, maybe? I don't know.
Sure.
Well...
He thinks he's far enough ahead, I guess, that he can save it.
I think Life Coach probably knows there's no ritual. Like, he's definitely the type of guy that would study what his opponents are playing the night before. But maybe just thinks Orange will extend more into the Storm and maybe thinks this is, like, a spot where Orange makes a read that if he had Storm, he would have played it.
Sure. It's very reasonable. I think, though, Orange has very limited options aside from, you know, Lance Carrier and kill the 7-4. I can't imagine he goes Brand Lance Carrier face, right?
Yeah. I mean, Brand Lance Carrier is the play, but then you probably just trade. You definitely just trade.
Yeah. Be hard-pressed to go face there.
And also, you want to protect the brand because you have Defender of Argus and Lance Carrier in hand. So if these two minions survive, then all of a sudden next turn you have,
an explosive turn.
A 3-4 with taunt and a 4-6 with taunt.
Well, and also
it'd be a 5, it'd be like a 7-4 with taunt and a 4-6 with taunt.
All right. So here as Life Coach, you just Flame Tongue, kill the 1-2, then hex the brand and set up for that sweet Thunder Bluff.
Seems
super
good.
Buff.
That is exactly the play I would do.
Yeah.
And I think Life Coach will come to that conclusion. He just likes to think a long time.
Actually, this is pretty quick.
Yeah, I mean, there's very few options in this turn.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the other two cards are just so weak. Like.
Mm. the Revenge of the Frog can strike.
Still not an awful turn from Orange.
Yeah.
Gets to deal with the second Flame Tongue very easily.
Lance Carrier coming in.
Is that boy.
It's not bad.
He's a 3-2 now.
2-3?
But the,
no.
The Frog.
Oh, you're talking about the Frog. I thought you were talking about the Lance Carrier.
Ribbit.
You need to, you know, verse up on your memes.
No, I know. Mm.
Storm is a bit awkward, but it does allow you to play Fire Elemental the following turn.
I like Thunder Bluff.
You still like the Thunder Bluff. Didn't you kill the Frog?
Like, yeah. It has Taunt, basically, and your opponent doesn't have the damage on board to answer it. So he's going to go out of his way to kill it. Then you...
It's so weak to Power Overwhelming, though.
Is it? I mean, it's as weak as Fire Elemental.
Well, I don't think you Fire Elemental either. I think the play is either the Thunder Bluff, like you said, or the Storm Totem.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm more of a fan of Storm Totem, honestly.
Yeah, you Storm Totem, then you have Fire Elemental next turn.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And then your Thunder Bluff's even better.
I kind of like the Thunder Bluff just this turn.
Mm. It's definitely an option. Those are the two options, right? The Fire Elemental's never the play.
Yeah.
He is really holding on to that Storm, though.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, you really telegraph that you don't have it. And
yeah, I would never put Life Coach on Storm here if I'm Orange.
Yeah, but what if he just doesn't draw into a board that's vulnerable to Storm anymore for the rest of the game?
At this point, it's just a mathematical like frequency thing, though, where either Orange is going to draw cards that play into Storm or he's not.
Yeah.
And in this case, he kind of didn't. He picked up Doomguard. But
yeah. Do you even play Doomguard here, or do you go with the Power of Warming tap?
I think you Power of Warming
PO
tap
is significantly better.
Yeah.
I mean, you get the value trade in the totem as well.
Well, I mean, you get the value trade in the totem either way.
Yeah.
A horse rider is no help here. That feels bad, man.
Well, you can play it next turn.
Yeah.
So, it's probably just Fire Ellie Totem.
Seems good, man. Storm 4-5 is not the worst, but... then if your opponent Doomguards it, you can Fire Elemental their guy.
Yeah, if he Storm 4-5.
Yeah,
so,
but if
I have no idea.
Doomguards your guy now. Just have Storm.
Yeah.
Dick but killing the non-taunt.
1-1's good.
That's awkward.
The discard conundrum.
Well, he should have rolled the totem first, right? And then if it is the 1-1, you definitely kill the 2-2.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if it's a 0-2, you can then start to think, like, is it worth it to kill the taunt instead?
Yeah.
So.
Uh-oh. Yeah, Orange is not putting Life Coach on Storm. Not even a little bit.
Well, I mean, it didn't really have a choice.
Point, at this point, not much of a choice. Now, Manatide makes things interesting.
It's Totem Master of Evolution.
Yeah.
Storm, right?
Yeah, I think so. You got to have stuff on the board to challenge.
Yeah, and then he just rolls Doomsayer on the
Master
of Evolution.
Yeah, that's actually the worry here. Is like,
yeah. Maybe you Master of Evolution first, then Totem, play around Doomsayering yourself.
Or you don't Master Evolution this turn.
You just go.
Well,
but the
Manatide
Totem
Manatide
doesn't trade with anything, though.
Yeah, but it gets
problem.
You more cards. Like, you're in a spot where I think with enough cards, you usually win this game.
Yeah, the question now isn't how to win, it's how to win the most.
Yes.
Yeah.
And Doomsayer is a real thought where you're like, okay, that just adds a little bit of percent to my loss rate.
Yeah.
A very tiny amount.
Yeah, so I wouldn't be totally surprised to see him go with the Manatide just to play around Doomsayer.
You can even Master Devo the Manatide into a 4-drop if you like it. Like next turn.
He's going for it. And he's putting it down. Running out of time.
This is one of the rope turns that I actually, you know, very much can visualize why he's roping. You know?
Yeah.
This is a lot of math to be done.
He's going for it. Taking the risk on the Doomsayer. Gets rewarded. Yeah.
All right, TJ, do you know what that card is named?
Sparring Partner.
Nailed it.
Nailed it! I made a Sparring Partner deck.
Why?
With Black Knight and Bolster.
I didn't have Black Knight.
You didn't have Black Knight?
How do you not have Black Knight?
I didn't have room for it. It was actually an aggro.
There's just so many good cards that go with sparring partner.
It was an aggro sparring partner deck. You think I have room for 6 drops? It topped out at Leroy.
Why'd you have sparring partner then?
Yeah, it's the defensive card.
No, it's an offensive card.
Why?
So you can protect the other things that have better attack than it does.
But you...
So were you also running Dusk Boar?
No. Well, that's a good idea, though.
No, it's not.
No, it really is. No, you're onto something here.
All right. Yeah, at that point, you should have also just put in, you know, Mukla and Millhouse Manastorm.
Which Mukla?
The 3-1.
Both.
The Tyrant of the Vale?
No. That one's too expensive.
Yeah, you're right. I top out at 5.
Does that one always give you plus? Does it always give you +1/+1 bananas, or does it give you like the weird bananas?
What weird bananas?
You know the one banana tavern brawl.
Oh, I don't think there's any weird tavern brawl cards that have ever been
bananas. They were like, you know, you got rotten bananas that dealt 1 damage. You got like the big banana that gave +2/+2.
No, they're
just
that's
what we need.
Banana.
We just need more banana related RNG in the game. That's.
I feel like that might be too much of a buff to Stan Sifka.
That's gonna help it.
Like he'd be too great in that meta.
Have it. That would be his meta for sure. Yeah.
1 year from now, I can envision it. The strongest deck in the format's gonna be Banana Yogg-Saron Druid.
That would be pretty nuts. Why don't we put Mukla in Yogg Druid? What if we just broke the meta right here, right now?
You get enough spells already, anyway.
Okay, thanks. Just crushed my
party
dude.
Pooper.
I mean, you can run Illidan. It's pretty fun in Token Druid.
That's
not impressed. I'd rather have the Tyrant of the Vale. But going back to this game, Orange is dead.
Yeah, there's 2 mana tides. Orange is still playing Zoo. His deck doesn't have recovery mechanisms. Because all the recovery mechanisms that Zoo could run, which was just, you know, Implosion.
Yeah.
Is,
what was that? that move?
That's how that it throws out, you know, it throws imps. But, yeah, that's been removed from the game, or at least from Standard, so.
I wish that move was caught on camera.
Yeah, the throwing
like
of the imps. Yeah.
You're like Spider-Man throwing a web, but it's imps.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, so Zoo doesn't really have recovery mechanisms. Once they start falling behind, they're done, Zoo.
So what does Orange have to 3-0 with now? He's got a Warrior left. That's not an awful deck to have to 3-0 with, but it's got to beat Rogue, Mid Shaman, and Token Druid. So.
Yeah, and Life Coach's Token Druid's very greedy. It's got, you know, Cenarius and Onyxia and Sylvanas.
2 wars.
And 2 wars. So it's just got so many threats in it that it's going to be pretty strong against Warrior, which is why he doesn't ban Warrior with his lineup. All of his decks are fairly reasonable against Warrior.
Yeah.
I'm surprised Orange didn't queue the Dragon Warrior into the Mid Shaman. That's a very favorable matchup, I'd say, for Dragon Warrior.
Yeah, and I mean, looking at Life Coach's other decks, I feel like the Aggro Zoo is pretty good against Druid.
Yeah.
And it's you know, 50-50 against Rogue, I'd
say. Yeah, it has
maybe a little
fires.
Lower because Life Coach's list is pretty anti-aggro. It's got Squire, it's got Dark Iron Skulker, but...
Okay.
Interesting queue order there. I mean, there's a lot to be said about LHS pick order when you fall down 1-0. Like, that's a very controversial point.
Maybe he just isn't comfortable with Dragon Warrior against Mid Shaman, but, like, I'm not crazy. That's favored for Dragon Warrior, right?
Is it?
I'd say so.
I don't know.
I'm in the camp where that's, like, one of Dragon Warrior's better matchups of all the matchups. Because Dragon Warrior's got a lot of well-rounded matchups all around. Like, not too favored or not too unfavored
right.
Most of the time. But the ones where it really shines is against the Aggro Shaman and the Mid Shaman, I'd say.
Well, Aggro Shaman, I definitely agree with you. Like, I feel like once you kind of kill their early minions, they don't have much going for them. But I feel like Mid Shaman definitely can go the distance and kind of beat you, especially with double hex. But it's definitely a close matchup.
That's a good card.
That is. It's a 3-3 charge.
Yeah.
Wolf Rider, eat your heart out.
It's just better than Wolf Rider. Man, Wolf Rider seems like such a terrible card next to Alexstrasza's Champion.
Yep. Wolf Rider seems like a terrible card next to a lot of things nowadays.
Yeah.
Duskbore.
like sparring partner. Why would you ever play Wolf Rider when you could play sparring partner?
Yeah.
No. Why not both? You protect the Wolf Rider.
Oh my gosh.
With the sparring partner.
Wow. Genius.
Yeah.
Thank me later, guys.
The best. I think we're just going to be slamming here, taking the trade.
Yeah.
I would also like to see Blood to Ichor come out, make it 2-2.
Yeah, I think, his next turn's occupied no matter what.
Yeah, it's going to be the 4
Guardian.
Drop.
Mm-hmm. And then you have to think about what you're doing on 5. If you draw Blackwing Corruptor, you're definitely going to be doing that on 5, so that would occupy all your mana. If you go, like, slam Fairy Dragon, then yeah, maybe you could fit in the Blood Acre, and I think that's what he's thinking if he's not going to Blood Acre this turn, but...
I just like being as aggressive as possible against...
Yeah, I think I do, too.
Dominating the board, getting in chip damage.
Yep.
But he's going to save it for maybe a potential turn 5 play.
Yep.
Double Tuskar Totemic early on can be pretty rough.
Oh. Flame Tongue, not too backbreaking here.
Yeah.
You just have to kill it.
Yeah.
We'll have to see if that Blood Acre comes in big. To me, this just looks like the Flame Wreathed.
I could potentially see double Flame Tongue Totem to set up for Doomhammer the following turn.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because they'll buff each other after you trade in. So yeah.
They're going to be really weak this game.
The problem is, though, if you do that and they Blackwing Corruptor, you just lose.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yeah, so that's the big risk. And then the other line is the Flame Wreath Faceless, and if they execute, you just lose. So
pick a card to lose to.
Yeah, and we're going to execute this time.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, execute, you also have to trade in something or have an activator.
Yeah.
Blackwing Corruptor, you know that there's already a dragon. Activator,
and you know there's one. Okay, yeah.
So,
yeah,
so then this is the better play for sure. Yeah. Okay, I like it.
Okay, so Blood to Ichor doesn't help too much.
No. It could have gotten in 4 damage already, though.
Yeah, you can obviously start with Slam. And, yeah, now you're in a weird spot because the other thing Life Coach did is he set himself up for a Storm Top deck.
Mm-hmm.
And Orange has to really be considerate of how likely that Storm is.
It looks
like he is disrespecting it entirely.
Yeah. I don't think you can really respect it at this point.
Yeah.
If he has it, you just lose anyway. You can't... Well, there's not one, so...
Unlucky.
So to speak.
Or lucky, you know, if you're on the flip side.
Yeah.
I like it. If a Storm comes out, Orange doesn't care, though. He follows up with, you know, the God curve. He's got, like, the Secret Paladin curve at the moment, you know? So, like, Storm comes out, that takes Life Coach's whole turn, right? If Life Coach, you know, doesn't high roll on both of them, then his Flame Wreath Faceless may just die. And then Orange just plows down a 6-6 into a Malkorok, into a Rag.
Yeah.
So if your opponent's reacting to your board, I think you're happy about it.
Yeah.
So I like the risk.
It's definitely a risk, and it has a high payout when they don't have the Storm, so... He... cannot proc the battle cry on the Draconid, but I don't think he really wanted to anyway. The trades look nicer.
Yeah. Now, aside from Cursed Blade, he's got a really solid position here. But yeah, this is why I would have liked to see him queue like Dragon Warrior into Mid Shaman instead of the Zoo into the Mid Shaman.
There's certainly some merit to not going with your strongest deck immediately, depending on those two decks' matchups against the other two decks in the lineup. But
Zoo's better against both of the other decks.
Yeah.
Did Life Coach even show his Shaman yesterday?
No.
So maybe he didn't know that it was Mid-Shaman.
Well, he played it after the
first game.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
He got Storm.
Unless it was just aggro Shaman with
Did he show any mid-range cards?
So game one was Mid-Shaman versus the Druid.
Actually, he showed Hex.
Okay, yeah, he showed Hex.
Yeah. And Life Coach is also just kind of
a Mid-Shaman guy. Mid-Shaman. Yeah.
That's
what he's been streaming and whatnot.
He does not play much aggro Shaman. I've never seen him play it. Now, to be fair...
Also, all of the G2 guys are playing the same decks.
You never know when Life Coach is just going to show up and be playing aggro. It happened to me at WCA. I thought he was playing Reno Paladin like he always did. He just had Seeker Paladin. He finally came around at the last tournament of the patch.
Sick. I really liked WCA's format at the actual event. It was you could switch decks every round. So
wait,
it's just like you mind games with your opponent.
Oh, the first part was really bad though.
Oh yeah. But at the
round
actual
round robin best of 3 is pretty atrocious.
Yeah, that was bad. But after that, once you got out of your group, then it was you get to switch your lineup between every opponent.
And it was time consuming.
It was really fun.
Somehow we managed to convince Firebat to play Anyfin.
I did. I played any Finn Paladin. The guy queued up every single game. He started round one with Reno Control Warrior. So I was just like, all right, I've never played any Finn before, but let's do it. Queued it up game one. He queued Reno Control Warrior again.
Nailed it.
Yeah.
And you wrecked him?
Yeah, I killed him on like turn eight.
What?
Turns out Reno Control Warrior is just a bad deck.
Oh my god.
Sage advice from the world champion.
Oh man, well, life coach is in a pickle.
Yeah, we seem to be getting to these board states in the past three games where it's around turn seven or eight and a player is just dead.
Does he run Elemental Destruction?
No.
All right.
That's a big no.
Okay. Is it...
Hex in the Lightning Storm, next two cards.
Maybe it's Tunnel Truck, Doomhammer. Do you die too fast, though? You die really fast.
You die really fast.
You may need to, like, Thunder Bluff Totem and try and set up
try and
storm.
Draw a storm.
Yeah, and, like, stall that way. You need to stop getting hit in the face, and Thunder Bluff really helps you do that.
Yeah, this creates 8 points of health.
Yeah.
So
it's just the maximum amount of life gain for the turn.
Yeah, and it's still not going to be enough.
Yeah, he can set up a rag flip for lethal.
Oh, can he?
13 plus 8 is 21, right?
Yeah, it'd be a 1 and 3, so not a great flip.
What now? Seems like lethal to me.
I could say it's an okay flip.
Well, then then you actually can lose.
Yeah.
Why is it a flip? If it's a 1 in 3.
Exactly. That's what I'm
saying. Is there a three-sided coin?
No. Technically, all coins have three sides, right?
No.
Whoa.
There's the front, the back, and the side.
Well, like if you count each ridge individually.
Well, I guess. Depends if the coin has ridges or not, and that depends where you're from, right? Or do they all have ridges? Some of them
I
are
guess
smooth.
Some don't.
Yeah. Huh. So it's more of a location, so it's a geographical question.
Yeah.
Okay.
Glad we settled that.
Getting into semantics now.
All right, I liked his play. He was able to kill the spell part on him, set up a 50-50 with Rag. If it goes face, he is lethal with Corcoran Elite, even if his board gets cleared. And if he kills the Thunder Bluff, then the Thunder Bluff is then dead.
I like the way he played the 6-7 and the 8-drop on curve.
Yeah, I do like the way he went 6-drop, 7-drop, 8-drop. That was...
marvelous.
Really fantastic play.
It's too bad his 6-mana 6-6 didn't pull things for free out of his deck.
Yeah, it's unfortunate that they've nerfed this deck now, and now it's Warrior and also less secrets.
It really is the same deck. Blizzard, please.
Well, that's going to be Orange putting himself on the board at least.
Here we go.
Going to go to 2-1.
And that is probably the hardest win, I think, out of the three. Obviously, it's still hard to just win three games straight with any deck.
Yeah.
But, like, I would say that's the hardest matchup out of these three.
Rogue Maybe. Is the hardest matchup.
You think?
Yeah, if you don't have, like, Rag on 8 or, like, a decent bomb train like he had this game, then Rogue's really tricky because you have a really hard time killing Gadgets and Auctioneer.
Yeah, like, that is true.
Legit, a lot of times they can play it on turn 6 if you don't have anything on the board or they just backstab your one guy.
They just make a 6-6 Van Cleef and you have no answer and they cold-blood it and you die.
You have actually quite limited removal in the Dragon Warrior deck. And
Actually, something I was hearing was people keeping Execute. I think Purple was talking about it. He just keeps Execute against Rogue.
Yeah, I think that's
I don't fine. Dislike that.
Yeah, it's just because you have such limited removal, and if any of the rogue minions stick, you just die.
You're very dead.
Yeah, so that's what makes the matchup so difficult for Dragon Warrior sometimes. When on paper, it seems like the Warrior would be aggressive enough. It's just a little bit too slow, and a lot of people have been adding things into the Warrior, like Onyxia and Deathwing, that also slow down the deck a little bit more.
There's Van Cleef, but there's no coin, which is, you know.
Well, you have Deadly Poison Backstab.
Yeah, I mean, you probably keep this whole hand.
Yeah, I wouldn't hate mulliganing away the Van Cleef, but I would prefer to keep it.
Van Cleef is I'm pretty sure, the only reason to play Rogue.
It is the
if
best.
If that card was gone, I don't think Rogue would be viable at all. So
going to break out the spreadsheet.
You know, the spreadsheet, I'm working on it. There's some extra pages now.
It's not just Rogue stuff.
You know, it's got some asterisks. It's like, well, if it's Life Coach piloting and he draws this way and apparently you don't fireball a Tomb Pillager. And
he got rid of the Van Cleef. No coin. Feels it's not worth it enough.
And
I don't hate it either way.
Orange threw away both Executes and only kept Twilight Guardian.
This is probably the first decision with life coach I really disagreed with is pitching the Van Cleef.
Well, it doesn't matter here. Now he's going to be able to make...
Simply draw it.
He's going to be able to make like an 8-8 Van Cleef and win the game.
Exactly. So why would you ever pitch it?
I don't.
And how do you lose the game as orange? You lose to an 8-8 Van Cleef. So why would he pitch both?
He pitched both executes, yep.
Yeah.
It's really hard to keep an execute in a deck that wants the curve out.
I don't think you want to keep the execute.
I would tend to agree.
Jackie did it yesterday. Kept an execute. What matchup was that?
I kept an execute against Druid.
Depends what the other cards are.
I feel like one of the ways you lose is an early teacher. And then if they don't have early game, you just save it for the war.
Why didn't Life Coach poke with the dagger and then re-dagger this turn?
I don't know.
There's no battle rage.
Just a missed damage, I guess.
Yeah, he's missed one damage here. Because now he's just going to poke with a dagger and re-dagger, right?
Yeah, you just go backstab, poke. You never deadly here.
Oh, you want to use the backstab already.
What's coming on turn three, though? Usually, he's got the coin.
You could just save both backstabs and go for a bigger Van Cleef, is what you're saying? Yeah.
Yeah, you could. I like actually killing it, because you have to expect
just
with the coin. Expecting with the coin, you should expect Twilight Guardian, right? Twilight Guardian or Core Crown Elite. But you know he has a dragon in hand. You know he kept one card. Twilight Guardian comes to mind as a card that could be there. It could be War Axe as well. But I think you're right on the backstab dagger hit it.
Yeah, I feel like one thing...
I think every time you're supposed to dagger...
I guess he's just Van Cleefing now, yeah.
Okay.
Just goes for the baby. The tiny.
This does set up a lot better against Twilight Guardian.
Yep.
Now you can backstab Abyss, re-dagger, backstab Abyss,
Cold Blood. Yeah, Cold Blood and start going.
All right. Yeah, the more I look at this play, the more I like it.
And Life Coach is going to be pretty happy because that was his plan.
He is going to kill him.
Plays right into it.
Ooh.
Ooh.
That's really good, too.
Yeah, I think you just do that.
Just backstab trade that guy.
Wow, it's almost like Rogue has a lot of good cards.
Man.
I don't...
That's not true!
I don't hate either of these lines. It's really tough to say which is better.
Now I'm just really pulling for orange. You made this personal.
Yeah, I think the Tomb Pillager is slightly better. Like, the Van Cleef's just too vulnerable to, like, execute slowing you down too much. And even, Core Crown leading it, being kind of awkward.
Yeah.
Like, you still maintain the tempo, and you're able to push 8 that turn, but I think it's better just to backstab Tomb Pillager trade. Diversify your threats more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's adding 5 power to the board instead of 4.
You're only really weak to Ghoul Execute.
Yeah. It's close, though, between those two plays.
And running out of resources, he's going to re-dagger. Or use his dagger because he knows he's going to re-dagger.
Yeah.
Fairy Dragon. Ugh.
Yeah. Ugh.
He does have the 6-7-8 curve, though, so if Orange is able to kind of weather this storm out a little bit, maybe pick up a little bit of piece of removal here.
Yeah, still at high health, but...
Ooh, that's a good draw.
I don't know, is it?
I would play it, yeah. There was no ghoul presented last turn, which I feel would be better than the Fairy Dragon Slam.
I'm just kidding.
Oh, okay.
That is the best draw on a stack.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking this as well.
I feel like Life Coach draws
like I'm going crazy.
Really well with this rogue deck.
I think you Azure Drake and then punch him in the face for 5. I don't think there's any reason to trade with the Fairy Dragon. They don't run buff cards in the Warrior deck. They don't run Battle Rage.
There's no South Sea Dragon.
Look, when Life Coach doesn't even go to the rope, you know it was a good turn.
Yeah.
Andrel's Violet Teacher, so...
Okay.
A hand early on that was just chock full of spells.
Orange has the blood to Ichor to react, but it's so slow to kill something and play a 2-2 that it may just be better to play Azurdrake, but you can almost always expect Azurdrake to be met with removal against Rogue. So I'm kind of actually leaning towards the trying to stay alive play and just slow down the game and go Blood Taker armor. Like, actually, because, like...
That's rough.
What are the odds that the Azurdrake influences the game at all and lives, right?
It's true.
Like, you can almost guarantee it's going to get, like...
50-50.
Eviscerated or Sapped even is pretty powerful against it, or Shadow Strike. So I personally favor this play from Orange here. He's just trying to slow the game and last to his higher costing cards, and maybe he can win at that point. It's just so unlikely the Azure Trake is actually impactful. Unless he runs Inner Rage and rips that off the top of it.
Yeah. What do you think of the Inner Rage? Inner Rage is weird. It's like a card that doesn't do much unless it's a very specific situation.
It's really good for fighting for board in like grindy tempo matchups. So against Zoo, against Shaman, and even Token Druin to some extent, I find it to be quite impactful. Combos nicely with Azure Drake. Combos nicely with your weapon to kill 4/4s, which would be helpful against Rogue, for example. So just that extra little bit of removal tool can help you in those sticky situations where Dragon Warrior is unable to remove things when they're just stuck with these big clunky minions in their hand.
Is it like a replacement for Blood to Acre? You just run like one Blood to Acre if you're
No. It's worse than Blood to Acre, so it's like an addition to Blood to Acre.
It's kind of a replacement for Slam, because Slam is honestly one of the weaker cards in the deck.
Yeah, you can either replace Slam or you can replace some of the minions, honestly. Make your deck more fluid.
Yeah.
So you'd replace like a weak minion or the mid-tier minion with Inner Rage, and then replace one of your halfway high-tier minions with like a really high-tier minion. So you lower the consistency of the deck, but keep like the mana curve very similar.
Yeah.
So you, instead of being like a nice linear curve, you have more early game, more late game, less mid game. Mm-hmm. So your draws still balance out fine.
Yeah.
So the mathematics behind it.
Yeah, that's where like the Onyxia and the Deathwing come in, with also the Inner Rage coming in to balance everything out. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Life is all about balance.
At least in Dragon Warrior, yeah.
You should have like a motivational speaking series.
And we see here Orange again following with the same line of play from the previous turns, where he is taking the most defensive line possible, trying to remove as many things. This line really is kind of like, I really hope my opponent never draws Gadgets and Auctioneer, because if they do, I'm screwed.
Yeah.
But I honestly like his line of play. He plays very nicely around Sap and stuff.
If Life Coach's hand is just spells, the play works out really well, I think.
Yeah.
The fact that it is a minion and a Cold Blood is kind of a... Not worst case. Worst case would just be, like you said, Gadgets End, but
it's pretty bad.
And he's you're pretty dead.
Just going to put him to 9.
Yeah. And hold down to this coin so he can coin Eviscerate, or he can honestly coin this turn for an extra 1/1. I didn't do the math quite on it, but I think he's got enough damage.
Yeah. And that should be game. I don't think there's any way.
Gladiator's Longbow?
Would that even do it?
Not on board it would.
On board,
yeah. Yeah. Well... That's going to be Life Coach taking game 4, and that means he takes the series, goes on. He's going to move on to the winner's group, or the winner's match of Group A. Really impressive stuff.
Yeah. The only thing I think about that series that I didn't like too much was the fact that Orange queued that Zoo second into the Shaman instead of going with the Dragon Warrior into the mid-Shaman.
Yeah. Sure. Make room for the coach. The coach of life.
Danke.
What's up, man?
Hey, guys.
Congratulations.
Thanks very much.
So, first off, you have a tough group. It's probably one of the toughest groups that was redrawn today.
Okay.
Zixo, Orange, you are in the group, and Zalay. What do you think overall of your group?
I hope it's doable.
Yeah? Well, you started off with a nice, pretty good first win. So, I want you to talk about, you talked a little bit about yesterday, your Druid deck. It's very greedy.
Oh yeah, but there is no Yogg in it.
No Yogg?
Mm-hmm.
Are you just trolling everybody and telling everybody that there's no Yogg in it, or is there actually a Yogg?
Well, we saw like kind of a lot of games with it, right? Like I think 4 or 5 games now, so.
Yeah.
Yogg would really be hiding like I think we saw all cards basically.
Yeah. Also, you didn't bring Warlock. What was your choice not to bring Warlock when many people brought it in this format?
All right. Yeah, I mean, with sometimes the Shaman ban, you could have an argument to bring, let's say, Reno Warlock. But I feel that Reno Warlock, despite being able to ban Shaman, is still too weak of a choice. Mm-hmm. And simply because it loses against a lot of mid-range decks. And, then there is only Zoo, which is definitely viable. But, I mean, all people who know me know that I despise Zoo. So like, you will probably not see me playing Zoo. I mean, you haven't seen me playing Zoo in the last 2.5 years.
Yeah.
And chances that you will ever see me playing Zoo are probably very, very tiny.
Well, we talked about it earlier. Nobody thought you would ever play Secret Paladin. And then you brought Secret Paladin out at the end of the at the end of right before standard.
That must be out of frustration for sure.
Well, maybe one day Zoo will become so good that out of frustration you'll just end up playing Zoo.
Well, maybe. I mean, let's see what Blizzard will pull off regarding Zoo, but I guess there are also enough, let's say, voices that Zoo should not get more powered, so I would doubt if that would happen.
Yeah. I kind of already know the answer to this, knowing you, but are there any players that you're particularly afraid of moving forward in the tournament?
Uh-huh. Well, I guess all of the players here are extremely strong players, so I just hope that my performance is correct, because I don't think in this field we can hope for mistakes of the opponents.
Yeah.
So I just try to perform as good as possible, and if I achieve this, that's good enough, even if I bust out.
What about any decks that you're afraid of? The new Shaman deck?
No.
The Conceit Shaman? You're not afraid of Conceit Shaman?
No, I'm not.
Okay. What do you think of that deck overall? Do you think it's strong?
About the Conceit Shaman?
Oh, you have a visitor.
Hey, Lisa. How are you doing? You just want to say hello to the watchers? No.
No, she doesn't.
She refuses. Okay. Good. I mean, I think the deck is okay. I'm wondering whether it's top tier, whether it has top tier potential, because, I mean, once there are any kind of rogues in the field, I mean, Conceit Shaman might be having a very bad time against rogue, Zap, and things like this.
Things like this, yeah. Yeah, it's pretty strong. Do you guys have any questions for Life Coach?
Not that I can think of. Pretty strong performance. I think you're going to do great in the tournament, and best of luck.
Thank you very much.
Good job, man. Good job. Well, we are going to go to a quick break before we jump into the next matchup of Group A. But plenty more Seed Story Cup action to come, guys, so don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.